In the last video, we took a whistle-stop tour of the immune system, describing the different layers and highlighting some of the key players in the immune response. In this video, we're going to take a more in-depth look at the first layer of the immune response, the barriers and chemical mediators that prevent pathogens entering our body. Pathogens that are trying to invade our body from outside take on a variety of different forms, including bacteria, fungi, or protists, which are parasites like malaria, and finally viruses, like the one that causes COVID-19. Now, given that there are so many different types of disease-causing organisms, it makes sense that they can get into our body in different ways. In the case of the COVID-19-causing SARS-CoV-2 virus, you're susceptible via your respiratory system. But you can also ingest pathogens through your digestive system, or they can invade via the urogenital tract. And just something to consider at this point, your insides are actually outside. If you think about it, you have a hollow tube that runs all the way from your mouth to your rectum. So we need a way to defend ourselves from outside threats. The final way for pathogens to enter our body is via breaks in the skin. Our skin is the largest organ in the body and provides a waterproof barrier that repels a vast number of the pathogens we encounter. But if we have a break in the skin from a cut or a burn, for example, that provides a route into the body for pathogens. Once inside the body, the pathogens have a couple of different ways they can move around. They can enter the circulatory system, so they move through the blood system, or they can use the lymphatic system, which is a parallel network of vessels that carry what is known as lymphatic fluid around the body. And this plays a central role in our immune response, and we will discuss this in more detail in a future video. Innate immunity has two distinct phases, the innate phase and the early induced phase. The innate phase is an immediate response as the components and mediators are preformed. This phase includes the barriers, but also some chemical mediators which aim to prevent entry, kill, weaken, or help mark a pathogen to allow the early induced phase to be more effective. The early induced phase relies on sensing the presence of a threat and then the production of mediators or recruitment of cells to the site in a process we call inflammation. The innate phase, or first layer of defense, is often described as the barriers. And these can be physical, in the case of the skin, sticky traps like the mucus that lines our airway or digestive tracts, and mechanical cilia that help move pathogens out of the body. If these get overwhelmed, we have more forceful means of elimination, like coughing, sneezing, or urination, which are all designed to help clear pathogens via the flow of bodily fluids. We also make our bodies hostile to invaders. Stomach acid, sweat on the skin, saliva in the mouth, or urine in the urinary tract all create environments that make it harder for pathogens to survive. And then we also have the chemical defences. For example, lysozyme enzymes in tears and sweat that help dissolve bacterial cell walls. In addition, bodily surfaces that pathogenic microbes can enter by are also home to the friendly or commensal bacteria that make up what we call a microbiome. And these add another level of defense, making it incredibly hard for pathogenic organisms to gain a foothold on the surface of the body due to a lack of space and competition for the essential nutrients required for their survival. The surfaces of our body are covered by epithelial cells. So let's take a look at the biggest physical barrier, the skin, and see how this protects us. Many of the physical defenses rely on flow. In the case of the skin, this is the longitudinal flow of air and fluid across the surface of the skin, which can remove microbes from the surface. The skin is made up of many layers of epithelial cells, and within these layers are lamellar bodies, which secrete fatty acids, which seal the surface of the skin, creating a waterproof barrier. In addition, the skin can produce its own antimicrobials, called alpha and beta defensins, as well as S100 proteins, such as psoriasin or calprotectin, which target any invading pathogens that could breach the outermost layer. The outermost layer of the skin is made up of dead keratinocytes, which are regularly shed, thereby also shedding any microbes on the surface. The fact these cells are dead is in itself a defense, as viruses require a living host cell to replicate. If we contrast this with the stomach, The low pH of the environment not only helps digest food, but it helped create a relatively sterile environment, as many microbes are unable to survive at these low pHs. Some of our digestive enzymes are also capable of digesting microbial proteins and degrade these organisms. In terms of flow, there are the muscular contractions in the stomach that move fluid flow in and out of the stomach. The small intestine offers similar properties. Although the pH is higher than the stomach, it contains many digestive enzymes and antimicrobial peptides, which work better at this more neutral pH, which we find in the small intestine. And again, fluid flow flushes organisms along the gut lumen, preventing them from settling. If we move into the large intestine, we see a more extensive normal gut flora, or the microbiome, which can produce their own antibiotics to inhibit invasive microbes, and the flow becomes the expelling of feces. All these flow processes along the gut from the stomach through the small intestine and then into the large intestine is designed to prevent harmful pathogens from settling and being able to colonize our body. The other main point of entry is the airway and lungs. Forceful flow can be achieved by coughing or sneezing, but there is also a coordinated mechanical barrier called the mucociliary apparatus, which beats in sequence to expel mucus. The lungs also contain alveolar macrophages, which can phagocytose any invading pathogens, and these cells are aided by surfactant proteins called SPA and SPD, which help mark foreign invaders and make them easier for the alveolar macrophages to engulf. The uroadrenal tract primarily relies on the flow of urine to flush any foreign particles away, but there are also antimicrobial peptides and gel-like proteins called mucins that provide a protective barrier and trap foreign particles. Finally, saliva, tears, and breast milk also play a role in defending us against microbes, not only by flushing surfaces in the mouth, eyes, and breast, but also by producing antimicrobial substances like lysozyme, lactoferrin, or calprotectin. So that's an overview of the physical and chemical barriers at a more bodily scale. Let's take a closer look at the important cells that make up the surface and function of these barriers, the epithelial cells. Although we don't traditionally think of epithelial cells as part of the immune system, they play a fundamental role in the immune response. They not only form a protective barrier, but also protect underlying structures, taking on a cobblestone appearance, and they're tightly bound together through the formation of a variety of tight junctions. Epithelial cells are synthetic, and they are incredibly good at this, producing a range of soluble mediators very quickly that help direct the immune response. As well as the antimicrobial peptides, or AMPs, that we have already discussed, they produce the mucins and a range of cytokines and chemokines that recruit leukocytes from the blood to the site of infection or inflammation. As well as being highly synthetic, epithelial cells can detect the presence of microbes, and they do this through a series of receptors on and within the cells that are capable of recognizing conserved molecular components of microbes. We call these pathogen-associated molecular patterns, or PAMPs, and we call the receptors that detect these PAMPs pattern recognition receptors. We will cover these in more detail in a future video, but for now, all you really need to appreciate is that the epithelial cells act as an early warning system when they detect pathogens and kickstart the immune response through the release of cytokines and chemokines. What is important to realise is that although the barriers of the body are all made from epithelial cells, they are very different in their physical structures. The skin, for example, is totally different to the lining of the lungs, yet they are both made of epithelial cells. One forms a waterproof barrier. The other, in the case of the alveolar epithelial cells, a single cell-thick monolayer that is permeable to gases. There are also different physiological epithelial cells present in the lung. For example, the goblet cells that produce mucus, or those that have cilia and help flush this mucus out of the lungs via the ciliary escalator effect of the mucociliary apparatus beating in sequence to move the mucus up the airway to where it can be coughed up or swallowed. Compare and contrast this again to the gut, which contains at least four different types of epithelial cells, and probably many more that we do not yet know about. The ones we do know about probably originate in the crypts of the folded gut lumen, including epithelial cells, goblet cells that produce mucus, endocrine cells which release hormones, and pannus cells which produce antimicrobial peptides to help control the extremely high bacterial load that these cells are exposed to. So remember, the epithelial cells can take on many different forms to create different types of barriers, which are important for normal bodily function, as well as the immune response. So this has been an overview of the function of epithelial cells, and I hope you appreciate that they are a lot more complex than just barrier-forming cells. They release numerous substances that help initiate and direct the innate immune response, acting like sentinels to provide an early warning system to the presence of potentially harmful pathogens or tissue damage. In the next video, we will look at how epithelial cells interact with cells of the innate immune system and their function as an introduction to the process we describe as inflammation.